Director Fund liabilities. We'll explain those a little bit more as we get towards, or you get to actually see them in particular departmental budgets later on this afternoon. Any questions? All right. With that, the public safety budgets, program area budget, Mr. Stuckey.
Yeah, well, just to kick this off, we've taken your feedback in the budget process from last year to reconfigure this process a little bit, to provide you a little more time at the end of the process, especially in April, to give some additional feedback and really time to process some of what you see in these departmental presentations. So we've streamlined them a little bit, put them in these program areas or organizational groupings. We think that'll help. The presentations will be a little shorter than they've been in the past to help provide that time and, you know, give you an opportunity to process that. So we are doing that, but we're also still preserving what we've always done, which is an opportunity for you to hear the voice of your departmental leadership, and think that's important to hear what's going on, what the needs are. And so we're still doing that, but just within a little different framework that we think will streamline the departmental and budget committee component of this process. So we're going to kick it off with our largest single area of emphasis in our general fund, which is the public safety function. That includes our police department, the drug fund, which they oversee and operate, our emergency management function, which is a new set aside function that we've identified in the last year or so, and then our fire department. So I'm going to invite Chief Faulkner and her team up here to talk about the police department and the drug fund, and we'll take this through and glad to answer your questions as they present. So Chief, take it away.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, Chief.
Appreciate you being here, and I'm honored to represent the men and women of the Franklin Police Department. They work very hard, and I'd like to tell you a little bit about our story for the past year, but first of all, I'll introduce the people who are with me today. Deputy Chief J.P. Taylor, Deputy Chief Scott Butler, my fiscal manager, Will McCarver, and this is his last budget hearing. He's leaving us for the state of Tennessee, so he'll be missed. And doggone you anyway. The heck with that. I came here to get away from the state, so just saying. Okay. Just to tell you a little bit about what the police department accomplished last year, some of the things I thought you might be interested in. Franklin police officers responded to over 81,000 incidents last year. They made 1,504 arrests. The top offenses were assault, drug or narcotic violations, and driving under the influence. During the Thanksgiving and Christmas holidays, officers worked the Not In My Mall initiative. We wanted to prevent criminal activity at area retail venues to ensure the public would be safe as they enjoyed the holidays. Our officers made 74 arrests during that three-week period, and they recovered over $31,000 worth of stolen merchandise. The department kicked off a DUI initiative last year, and they made over 431 DUI arrests in the city of Franklin. That doesn't include the ones that the county may have made in our jurisdiction, or even the ones leaving our jurisdiction that were arrested by the Brentwood Police Department. We have a zero tolerance for driving impaired. In fact, in the morning, I'm going down to Nashville in front of the Titans Stadium to announce the Fans Don't Let Fans Drive Drunk. And I'll be representing not only the city of Franklin, but the Tennessee Association of Chiefs of Police, over 1,200 members of that organization. The Sheriff's Association will be there, as well as Commissioner Long and Colonel Matt Perry, all Franklin residents, but representing the state of Tennessee. I am also taking Lieutenant Scott Legeza with me so that he can tell his story about what tragedy happened to him. We often have to work fatality crashes, and we have to notify families of what happened, the nearest kin, living relative. And unfortunately, Lieutenant Legeza got one of those calls 2 years ago, 3 years ago now, soon. Franklin officers worked 43 special events last year to include the larger ones like Pumpkin Fest, Pilgrimage, Main Street Festival, Dickens of a Christmas, a lot of parades, various charity runs, and the Heritage Ball, and of course, July fireworks, 4th of July, the downtown tree lighting at Christmas, and other events. You might say that the Franklin Police Department has a front row seat for everything that happens in our city on weekends, holidays, you name it. We're there to keep the city straight and to keep it safe. We tested, hired, and trained 3 classes of lateral officers. We currently have an active posting to fill our vacancies. Our honor guard was invited to present colors at several of the Predators games last year, and they'll be attending the National Law Enforcement Memorial in Washington, D.C. to honor Police Officer 2 Jeff Carson, who died in the line of duty last year. We retired the Blue Star flag from in front of our police headquarters when one of our officers returned from an overseas deployment. We currently have 1 officer deployed, and we'll have a 2nd one deployed next month. We have 40 military veterans serving the Franklin Police Department. We've maintained our law enforcement accreditation through the Commission on Accreditation for Law Enforcement Agencies. That is an international accreditation. We also have a state accreditation through the Tennessee Association of Police Chiefs. We continue to strive to be a professional law enforcement agency. We believe that the public that we serve expects the best, and so we try to provide that. This is the department that values human life, our oath of office, and the rule of law. Our policy and our training regarding the use of force is strict. There is a force continuum. There are no chokeholds. There's a duty to intervene and a duty to render aid should force have to be used. Officers train in de-escalation, and also we have a very comprehensive reporting policy. We do not have a unit like you've seen recently in the city of Memphis. What happened in Memphis is nothing like anything I've ever seen in my long career. The lack of humanity was beyond shameful. They violated the law, their oath of office, and now they're going to face a jury. Law enforcement's worst nightmare is an active shooter call. Our policy and our training has always been respond quickly, go directly to the threat, and stop it. Officers do not wait. We have breaching tools in the field 24/7, and if we have to, we'll use the push bars on the front of our vehicles to knock a wall down, a window, a door, whatever it takes to get inside. Now, the budget that we have submitted for your review and consideration represents the needs of the Franklin Police Department for the next fiscal year. There's not a lot of changes. No surprises in there. The increases that you will see are limited, but they are related to fuel cost, our Axon contract for body-worn cameras, and our fleet cameras. We have the cameras inside all of our vehicles, and an allowance for any inflation. I'm presenting 5 program enhancements in this budget. I carefully analyzed the needs of the department and narrowed them down to simply this: ones that replace outdated equipment or personnel required for a growing city. And if it's okay, I'd like to just go ahead and jump into those 5 enhancements, because I know you have other people behind me. The first one is a new incident command vehicle. The one that we have, that's not it, I wish it was, is 20 years old. And I'm sure some of my guys have names for it. Some I could mention today, and others I can't. It is often used for large events, like the special events I listed. We have it at Cool Springs Mall during the holidays, so it's a high-profile vehicle that people can see and realize that there's a police presence. We use it on high incident calls where our negotiators are called out. And if need be, it would be an alternate headquarters site for us should the building that we reside in every day would be out of service. The one we have is a 2003 Ford E450, and it's not reliable. If it was, we'd use it more. The second program enhancement, and I love that picture, that's our honor guard. This is to have three additional Master Patrol Officer positions. I'm requesting promoting three police officers that we currently have to the rank of MPO or Field Training Officer. You may or may not know that once a new officer completes their classroom training, they've gone through the training, they are assigned to an officer and patrol to further train, observe, document, and evaluate them on a daily, weekly, and monthly and quarterly basis. They evaluate their knowledge, their skill, their ability to perform as a Franklin police officer. They are on probation for a year. They check to see how they interact with the public that we serve. We haven't increased this number of MPOs since 2015. There are currently 12, and increasing it would allow us to let some of our MPOs rotate. Right now, because we're constantly hiring, it seems, they are constantly in a training cycle, so there's never any let-up time for them. So to expand it would allow new officers the capability of being with different trainers to be evaluated from different perspectives and on different shifts, because the city's different time of the day. The third one is for new rifle plates and carriers, and you can see the picture there. The ones that officers have now are 7 years old. We purchased these in the event that an officer responded to an active shooter call and needed extra protection. They have front and back panels, but they're extremely heavy and difficult to pull on in a hurry. There is a much newer version that is the same protection, but is lighter and easier to pull on and wear if they have to put it on quickly over their other uniform. It protects them in case the shooter has an AR-15, a rifle. The fourth request is to increase our overtime budget. Our software program recorded 476 overtime posts last year. This amounted to 976 hours of overtime. This is needed for officers to work overtime, and we've had to, you know, for the last 2 years, we've seen a consistent amount of increase in the overtime area. There are considerably more special events, additional requests for officers to assist with meetings and other community activities. I receive an overtime report every year, so I monitor this closely. And finally, the last request is to make sort of a slight increase in our dive budget. And this would only be should the officers involved in that have to replace some of their equipment. Oh, I thought somebody was coming in. Okay. To replace equipment that are critical to this unit, such as scuba tanks and dry suits. Not only do they train in an event to also work with the fire department should there be a flood or high water, but they also dive for evidence and recovery of items in high water. So those are my five requests. I think they're fairly straightforward. It's three equipment needs and an increase in overtime and the ability to add three additional training officers from current police officers. And I can get into the drug fund fairly quickly if you'd like me to go ahead and do that. Again, it's pretty straightforward. Nothing's changed from previous years. The drug fund is established by the state of Tennessee by state law. It's in order to set up an account for drug investigations. This revenue comes from drug offense fines, cash forfeited through the court system, or the sale of forfeited property from illegal drug sales. There are very strict guidelines related to this for the use of any of these funds, and we follow them to the letter. We're keeping this budget status quo again this year, and we'll never spend more than we would ever have in it. Trying to see what he's got up there. Oh, that's the drug fund. Okay. All right, so that's pretty much it for the police department. Fairly straightforward. I'm willing to help answer any questions that you have. Gone through this fairly quick.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Chief, I just had just a general question because this was high level on the rifle plates and carriers. Mm-hmm. What's the quantity that the 134,000 will buy?
Last time we bought 130, okay. And the way we did it was we sort of graduated it in, mm-hmm. and primarily the officers that are in patrol who are going to be the first responders, the ones in uniform. Patrol officers. So we did half at one point and then half the other. Okay. We have 145 budgeted positions right now. They're not all filled right now, but it's primarily our uniform officers in the field. A SWAT officers already have something similar.
And so this would outfit all active duty that are in the field?
Yes.
Okay.
What would you do with the old ones?
Well, yeah, we'd put them on gov deals, I guess, but they could only go to another law enforcement agency. There might be some. I mean, they don't have a shelf life like our regular body armor does. The fabric and the threads will break down. The ability, we have to replace those on a regular basis. And it, again, it's based on when you received yours, so it's on a graduated scale. We don't all get them at the same time. I mean, mine has been replaced twice since I've been here in 9 years. So it's every so many years.
First, we don't get a opportunity to do this, but thank you and to the Franklin Police Department. I went through the department yesterday, Leadership Franklin, and we've got first class set of individuals, first class facility, and this community, I'm going to get emotional, but this community should be proud of all of our public servants, including fire as well, but certainly got firsthand view yesterday. So this community supports our police officers and our firefighters. And
we know how blessed we are, particularly when we hire officers from other states and they come here and they say, you don't know how lucky you are. And but I know.
The citizens know it, and I represent 20,000 of them. And so from them to you, thank you.
Thank you for saying that. The
mobile incident command vehicle, I saw the fire's asking for one too. So I think there would be, and I'm sure this is, not rocket science, but maybe there's something we could, I know that there are certain situations and location where it's parked. I know there's logistics probably involved, but it'd be interesting for staff to engage on that and understand if there are some ways to have a single, to meet the needs of both departments that I know are specific and need their own space and equipment and so forth. But because, those are going to support our events and support our, all the... So that was the first thing that came to mind. The other thing was are these upgraded positions related kind of to the salary study that these are kind of one-off? Or this is just a... Are these some of those, like, cherry pick? Like, we know we need to make some adjustments after the salary study. I know you had said there might be some of that this next budget where a department head might say need to...
This is really an operational need for the department to have more officers in that master patrol role. So it's really more an organizational need.
Okay.
We've made adjustments related to compression and some other specific departmental issues, not just in the police department, but across the organization. So that's really being implemented. Really right now, we're rolling forward with those. So that's really related to the needs Chief and her team sees for having those additional officers in that role, especially as it relates to training, bringing new talent on board.
And we have 12 MPOs right now. I have 8 in training. I've got one about to be deployed and one to retire. And to be honest, they're getting a little worn out. In fact, I've had 2 that's asked for a demotion. It's like I can't do it anymore. So I'm mindful of that, and I want to give them a little more leeway and have additional ones that can sort of take up some of the slack.
The other, you know, on our special events, and I've gotten feedback that I know it's hard to staff those and fill. And so whatever we need to do, you know, is we answer the public and everyone else does too. But if there's anything that could be done with the neighboring, you know, departments, even where we, if there's budgeted funds that need to be, to get, make sure that those events do have everything you need personnel wise to make sure our events are fully staffed. And I could give you an example offline, but you know, we want to make sure, and if that ever is an issue and it's a budget issue that we need to, I don't know operationally how you all handle that, but there was a anecdote about, well, we couldn't get enough police officers to sign up for extra duty on a certain large event. And so if that's a financial, I guess our role is if that's a financial budget need to make that incentive enough to get people to sign up to keep the public safe, or, you know, then I think I don't want say, well, we didn't have the budget for it. Mm-hmm. So that was the only thing I think I had notes from this past year, comments related to budget.
So one of the things you did as a board a little over a year ago was up those special detail rates. And that has helped, I think, significantly. That new rate didn't go into effect until July of 2022. I think that has helped, but that's something we need to keep an eye on as we look at that. Really large events, we have expanded the footprint of those who we work with. We've brought sheriff's deputies in to assist us, and they can do that in certain roles. Other roles, we always want to make sure our Franklin officers is involved in that. But that is certainly something we're sensitive to. Those organizers largely pay those costs.
Sure.
But Chief will tell you, we augment every event with some additional resources and support because we just want to make sure they're safe. And sometimes there's specific skills, capabilities that we can only bring to it that we add to make them extra safe. And I applaud the department for taking that extra initiative, even though it costs us a little more. It is well worth it because we're here to keep our citizens and our visitors safe.
Yeah, and again, operationally, we don't have to get in the weeds. I mean, I don't need to be in the weeds, but the only comment basically was if there was a budgetary item that would make sure that everyone on the force, and you know, I just wanted to say that I'd be willing to consider that. But that's it. Thank you, Chair.
Well, would we be able to do command vehicles out of facilities tax?
I don't believe you would, because you already have existing vehicles that fill that role. What's that?
Does the fire department then, do they have?
I don't know that would fit that definition. We'd have to look at that.
Yeah,
we'd have to look at that.
Anything associated with growth would be, but not replaced, but
then. Yes, okay. That's exactly right.
Any other questions of the chief? Chief, we appreciate it. Thank you, guys. And you are in Tennessee right now. You don't have to go far to get in Tennessee. You're already here. Okay.
What's your state role going to be? So we know who to go. We know how to come shake down.
I'll be the Treasury Department helping with TCRS.
Good.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Okay, good.
Thank you for your
attention. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
We appreciate your support.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chief.
Do you all have anything to add?
Thank you very much. Appreciate you.
All right.
Let me invite Scott Willier up. Scott is our emergency management coordinator. You all know this, but we elevated this role within our organization a little over a year ago in terms of budgetarily, and Scott has come in, joined us last spring, and it's a function we've always had, but we wanted to elevate it and make it a focal point and place it in our central administration so it could coordinate and bring together resources across our organization, but also coordinate with county, state, and other communities to make sure we are responding and planning for emergency management needs, both in events that we know are coming and other things that can come our way, less planned or less expected, but that we have a plan and then we work through that together. So let me give Scott an opportunity to say hello and talk a little bit about what the emergency management function is about.
Thank you, sir.
Now and going forward.
Absolutely. Thank you, sir. And thank you, Alderman, for taking the time to hear me today. This is my first time being in front of you four. I hope there's more times, but as easy as this should be is what I'm hoping. I would be remiss, though. It's a quick budget brief, being that we're so juvenile as a department. But I do want to take a moment to thank the entire administrative department and Eric with the police department. I wish they were still here to hear this, and the fire department. There's a lot of veterans. There's thousands of veterans every year who end up homeless. One of those reasons is they have a difficulty transitioning from military life to civilian life, if you will. That was a worry of mine. But with the support of the entire city and everybody I've worked with so far, it's been success. And I greatly appreciate you taking the chance on hiring me as the coordinator. I appreciate the support from the entire administration department on the daily ins and outs of what it's like to work in City Hall, and then the police and fire department on standard operating procedures on responding to life-saving events, things of that nature. So I just want to give a public shout out to all the support I've received since I've been here. Thank you very much. To introduce the department, though, I would like to say the Emergency Management Department leads the city's emergency preparedness and is responsible for managing and coordinating the city's resources and responsibilities in planning for all aspects of emergencies. Emergency management promotes public awareness and manages and oversees the development, maintenance, and testing of a comprehensive all-hazard emergency management program for the city and the community. Our department develops the strategic direction necessary for the city to be prepared, equipped, trained, and ready to respond to the consequences of disasters, as well as to mitigate the effects and recover from the impacts. Our major accomplishments that we've had so far, and this is not even a calendar year as of yet, is we initiated and near completed the new emergency operations plan. That's for the entire city, and that gets integrated into the county's plan. We've initiated and guided all departments' continuity of operations program, so that's our COOP. For lack of better terms, that's what happens to City Hall. Where do our departments go? How do we maintain what the city provides to the community if something happens here? And that will be integrated into our plan on whatever the way ahead will be for our new City Hall. The COOP is incorporated into that plan. We've built and coordinated the city's first city debris management plan, and that will also get integrated into the Williams County Emergency Management Plan as well. If we move right along, the next slide, our organizational chart. As you can see, I'm a direct reporter straight to the city administrator. I do have one employee, Gino Fontoni. If you've met him, had the privilege, he is the best teammate that I could wish to have, and I'm glad he's stuck aboard and is working with me now. He has over 20 years experience in the city, both as a police officer and a fire paramedic, and his contributions to this department is unsurpassable. I'm very happy to have him, but sad that he could not be here today. Our budget, the only thing I want to note on this for the FY24 is that it's a nominal increase of FY23, being that we're so new. There are unknowns out there that we haven't yet identified. But a way of identifying those unknowns are to break down any future budgetary forecast into three categories. And whether that's going to be the strategic trajectory the EM department wants to go on, our operational requirements or needs, and our academic requirements. There will be certain certifications in academia that me and Gino need to meet to stay certified for this position. Yes. And we only have two PERs, so good news. We have a vehicle barrier system that's labeled the Archer 1200, which offers a flexible, modular approach to securing roadways and any other areas accessible by vehicles for events that we have here in town. They create great standoff and further deter any vehicles from entering our location, but the most beneficial thing they do is provide those barriers enable us to take back the fire apparatuses that we're using or the police vehicles that we're using or personnel to block those entrance points. So we'd be happy to have those. The second is the Weather DTN Transmission Network. What that is a Weather Sentry app that we can put on all city phones. And what that provides us is a vast network of weather monitoring and reporting. They include, but are not limited to, real-time radar, satellite, both infrared and visible, a real-time 250-mile radius of lightning managing information with customized zones. So meaning I can put a 20-mile radius around the city of Franklin downtown, if that's where we're having an event. And anybody who signed up on that platform will get that ding notice that there's lightning in our area. Thus, we can proceed forward with whatever plan we have. It also gives us storm corridors and weather information notices for an unlimited amount of users. So we're only asking to pay for 5 to actually have access to the platform, but it's unlimited users who will get the weather information pushed from that platform. This platform enables the Emergency Management Department to gain, package, and deliver a comprehensive weather report for the city, both current and future, and 70,000 total for both PERs. And that is all I have. Ladies and gentlemen, happy to answer any questions.
Any questions?
Yeah. Just the weather. So right now we don't have, because I've been the safety and emergency coordinator for an outdoor event in Franklin before, mm-hmm. and I was on my Weather Channel app trying to determine if there was lightning within six miles or whatever. We don't have anything like that now that...
We do, but we have been piggybacking off our streets department. They have the same platform. But if we try to piggyback on them and buy the network and use it on our phones, we would only have administrative rights to that. So we're using exactly what the street department uses. We just need our own platform in the EM.
I think that's good, because I think there's having that single decision point, you know, a single place to make that decision will help our event, yes, our events as well. I mean, that's critical, and you don't want to be the guy that calls off the event. I've been there before.
I've heard stories.
Yeah, and because lightning was, you know, I mean, it is what it is, but having that will help that relieve that pressure from our event coordinators too. I think that's good.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you. Great presentation. First time out. I was just going to ask just for verification, because Eric and I think we're at the installation the very first time that we tested the vehicle barrier system. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, good. And so this is now, we're moving to phase 2 now that we've tested it. It's worked. We're now going to implement this for the majority, if not all, of our barrier areas moving forward.
Yeah, I think that's what... emergency management is asking us to look at,
right,
just kind of buying more over time so that, okay, we can do more of that. As Scott referenced, we've used, you know, fire apparatus and, mm-hmm, you know, a sanitation truck and different things to help do that, which they're effective, but they also can block your ability to see beyond it. So you want to be able to both block the area, but also be able to see your surroundings a little better. So I think this provides us with that functionality. They seem to work really well. Our streets team has been deploying them. They have the ability to be used in other situations across the city for various other events to help secure them. So the flexibility, we've given them a good test in the last, mm-hmm, year, and this is just to continue to expand that. When we bought them last year, we actually purchased them through our hotel motel tax funds, because they relate to, mm-hmm, largely tourist-related events or attractions. So I'm sure as we explore this, that we'd probably go down that same path.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah. I was very impressed with when we tested them that morning, mm-hmm, and moved, mm-hmm, them around, how easy they were to move, but how solid they were in place, right, if something were, mm-hmm, to occur.
And it's a good force multiplier, because every fire apparatus we have just blocking a street is less one fire apparatus to go out to a call, mm-hmm, and so on and so forth. So our overall goal is to have every avenue of approach covered by a barrier and not a vehicle.
Thank you.
Alderman Peterson, any questions? Scott, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Scott.
I appreciate your time.
Questions?
If not, then let's move on to Eric.
Let's have the fire department.
Fire department.
That's good. Chief Johnson has quite a crew with us.
We're traveling up back.
I love seeing the police and fire uniforms. It makes me a little bit jealous, though. I kind of wish I had, you know, something special. Yeah. Yeah, they did give me a great shirt, actually, for the team talks.
Well, good afternoon, and appreciate your time coming here, listening to our request.
Get them two chairs.
I promise to follow suit with the first two presentations. I can't say enough about how honored I am to sit here as the fire chief of Franklin, representing this community, working for you, and working on this this great team right here. They are simply the best. They strive each day to bring what to the level of service that our citizens and visitors desire. So I just want to say thank you. So we'll start off here with a little bit of departmental things here. We're still maintaining our ISO 1. We're very proud of that. A lot of work goes into it, a lot of training hours, and so we're able, oops, I'm sorry. So I'm glad we're able to keep that ISO rating for another year. This year we had 10,820 calls. This was the first year that we've broke 10,000. That represents a 6.9% increase in the total number of call volume. We're still hovering around 68 to 70% of that being medical. And those numbers are just going to continue to increase year over year. Some of the major achievements that we've had this past year was we became a credentialed Type 2 Swiftwater Rescue Team, recognized by the Tennessee Emergency Management System and the Tennessee Mutual Aid Consortium. This Type 2 team is not made up of just Franklin, but also Franklin Police Department, Williamson County Sheriff's Department, and Brentwood Fire Department. We're designed to respond in the county, in the state, and out of state in the EMACRA deployments, as you've seen, that we've gone to some of our coastal communities during hurricane season. Another fact here, I know you've got this in your packet, but I want to highlight the community CPR. Last year, we did 95 trained community members. This year, in 2 months alone, we've already put on the books a total of 150 for February and June. And a lot of it was during the recent events of a live NFL game. We have gotten a lot of requests, and we want to train as many people as we can. We've got classes going on the weekends at night. We've had church and civic groups reach out to us, and we're going to accommodate everybody we can in order to do that. And Chief King's team does a great job of orchestrating this and ensuring those opportunities are available. As I said, we are an ISO 1 department, and with that comes a lot of responsibility of maintaining our readiness. This year, the men and women of the Franklin Fire Department completed 56,556 hours of training. That's an average of 332 hours of training per person. When you break that down, that they only work 10 shifts a year or 10 shifts a month, that's a lot of training that goes into preparedness and being mission ready when the call comes in. One of the things I'd like to thank is the city leadership and as BOMA is allowing us to purchase our apparatus through a bond issue. We've got engine 2 that is expected to be delivered in February of 2024. Tower 6 in December of 2024, and Engine 1 and Engine 6, January of 2026. These will be paid out of a bond issue FY23. What we found is these apparatus, if we had waited, experienced a 20% cost increase. So we're buying at today's dollars and paying for it in the future. These apparatus are looking about 30 to 36 months out. So there's in 1 year of 20% increase, we can save a lot of money. All right, now I'll let Chief King talk about fire prevention.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Michael. The next two slides just talk about new development and the construction process that we have in the city. Obviously, our inspectors are involved in that. Our plan reviewers are also involved on a daily basis with the volume that we've had. If you recall back in the two different COVID years, we had almost $1.5 billion in permitted construction, even with the theoretical slowdown. In the last year, I believe our number was $873 million in permitted construction. And so the majority of our time as a department is spent on commercial projects, new construction. And so that is what is represented on these two slides. And so if you look at the second page, which is the number of plan reviews, it's really important that we've picked those up. That's every single change to a building plus every new building. We're also involved in the planning commission process and so on. I will note that we have assigned a fire inspector to help do plan review within the last 6 months. And so we're capturing that data, but it's helping us meet deadlines. It's helping us build redundancy. Back to the first page about total inspections. If you notice there, all the new construction way outweighs the existing. The existing is usually complaint driven or other things that we notice that just come up in the course of doing business. So happy to answer any other questions that you may have about those two slides. Chief?
Okay. Thank you. All right, as far as our organizational chart, there will be some changes based on whether or not some of our projects gets funded. So we will be coming back to budget and finance at a later date to request that. I know you'll like to see us back. All right, our next slide is our base budget request personnel. Joanne?
So basically, we're looking at a 3.8% increase in our base budget. As Michael alluded to earlier, that we really can't give you a good amount on the personnel, but we can give you a good amount for the benefits. We're looking at almost an 8.3% increase just in the cost of benefits for next year alone.
All right. Employee turnover. I think last year when I sat here before you, I told you I had lost 8 people within the first 3 months. For calendar year 22, we lost 13 for a total. I'd like to say that the measures that the city leadership and BOMA put in place stopped the bleeding for the fire department and allowed us to retain and recruit firefighters. It took us a little while, but we were able to do that. I don't anticipate seeing that number grow. I anticipate seeing that number reduce. So I just want to say from all the men and women in the department, thank you for putting those stop gaps in place and allowing us to recruit and retrain or retain some of the greatest firefighters in the country. I think I can, off the top of my head, 4 went to EMS or hospital-based systems where they had, and several of them were just closer to home. And they were going for comparable pay. So they were actually getting the same amount of pay as what they were here, but they weren't getting that 2 hour or hour and a half round trip ticket or trip. And so they were saving a lot of money in gas. And, you know, they were driving an hour and a half. And one example I can give you is the guy went from to 15 minutes from home. Wow. So, you know, what happens a lot of times is when Franklin sets a salary, all these outlying departments will watch and then they'll match us. And they call us the donut hole. And then they'll catch people coming in and say, "You look, you don't have to drive all the way to Franklin. We're going to pay you the same as what Franklin does." And so that's what they do. It's a cat and mouse game we see on an ongoing basis. All right, Joanne.
So the next is our operations request. We're asking for about 11.9% increase in operations. This really is due to utility costs, diesel fuel costs going up, and just general inflation of goods and services that we're finding that we have to purchase.
All right, thank you. Chief Baltimore?
All right, next is the 9 firefighters. I believe we asked for this last year, but this is basically just to fill the gaps of the personnel that are receiving their Kelly days and also to offset the vacancies, reassignments, and injuries. As of today, we have 22 positions that can't be reassigned to shift due to vacancies. All right, administrative service captain. Right now, that's being done by the facial manager and also the battalion chief of administration. This position has become overwhelming for the both of them. So we want to utilize this for procurement, inventory, and facilities management. Training instructor coordinator. This is a 40-hour position we're asking for. It is to assist the battalion chief of training, and also it's be utilized to help us to teach EMS classes along with fire classes, and also our recruits. And this is to keep us from utilizing our existing personnel on shift. It causes a hardship on shift to have to move apparatuses around, and it takes from covering the city.
The last enhancement request on this page is for 3 fire safety officers. Those of you who've been here before, we've asked for this several times in the past, but it is for 3 new positions. It would be a person that's cross-trained in 3 critical areas. The first is as a safety officer to support the battalion chief. When the fire is out, they would immediately become an investigator to determine what resources we need to find the cause of the fire. And then other times during the day, and including weekends for special events, they would be involved in a code enforcement. Whether we have fire alarms and other things that need to be investigated and worked on from a code enforcement standpoint. So we're asking again for those 3 positions. Thank you.
All right, we ask for the reclassification of 3 firefighters to shift lieutenant. And we're asking this to be done within the existing personnel that we have. And the reason being, this is a unique, specialized piece of equipment that we're talking about. It has a high call volume, the highest call volume. It can be subject to mutual aid at any time. The physical size of it is the major thing. It's the size of a pumping apparatus that already has a lieutenant on it. So we're asking, this is the only piece of equipment that we don't have of that size, of that magnitude, that doesn't have an officer. And we're asking it to be funded. Also, by not doing this, this is allowing a firefighter to make decisions and not being compensated for it.
What piece of equipment?
Rescue 2.
Okay.
The heavy duty, I'm sorry, the rescue equipment.
Another one of our personnel requests is for us to reclassify one of our existing admin assistants to office manager. As we continue to grow, we've got greater responsibilities that are being placed upon us, and we're operating a small business within the fire department, and administrative duties warrant that we have somebody to actually, a manager, oversee those duties. And then the last personnel request that we'll discuss today is the addition of a master firefighter pay grade. This will bring parity back to between police and fire. Normally, our engineers in the past have always maintained that parity with detectives. Now there seems to be outpaced, and the duties and responsibilities also, although different, are both of them take specialized training and whatnot in order to be successful at that job. This would take the engineer and lieutenant pay grades and fill that position between lieutenant and captain. And this would be a total overall cost of all things involved, $259,022. As I discussed earlier, apparatus replacement is a lot different these days since COVID. And we've got 3 more coming online that we need to replace. And so we'll be asking again for a bond issue to fund ladders 4, 5, and 8. Their projected construction completion dates will be 30 to 36 months out. Vice Mayor Barnhill, as you alluded to, out of facility tax, we are asking for a mobile incident command vehicle, and I'll let Chief King address that.
Yes, in our request, there's 4 lovely pictures here for you to see, but it would support our operations at multiple events, special events, incidents, and so on. We now have 7 drone pilots and potentially adding more, and so really it becomes a base for all things information technology, drones, dissemination of that data to the operations group and managing that. We haven't had this capability before, and we recognize the need, therefore the request.
So that's the same as the police department?
Not quite. It's a little bit different. It's okay. More technology-based. We've been utilizing our drone program for other activities, not only just public safety, but also support of other city departments. One of the things that we've determined since we've started this program is we're able to keep our people off the river during swift water rescues. You know, a lot of times people will call and they'll say, well, I remember passing under MacArthur Bridge. Our personnel now can launch a drone with IR, whether it's at night or during the day, and locate those people. And we're hoping to upgrade later on to where we can have a speaker that can actually, they can just follow the beacon out. Instead of us having to put people on the river at night in a dangerous situation, we use technology in order to help. We are also using our drones in firefighting. We can give you numerous, we had a large fire over at CPS. And we were able to deploy the drone. The drone could actually find the heat signature from above, and it helped direct our fire crews in there. We've also used it at some of our, of course, you know, we're a retirement community. And we've been able to use our drone technology to help locate patients who have walked away from their facilities with utilizing that IR technology. Also out of facilities tax, it says replacement, but I don't think that's, this is an addition, is the air light response vehicle. This will give us a long duration on scene where we can support ourselves with breathing air and with lights. As we continue to respond to some of our more hazardous target hazards, such as the interstate, the need for proper lighting is important for the protection of our men and women. And Alderman Plotz, I know we talk about this every year, but new Tower 7. You know, we know at some time with the growth going on in Berry Farms that we are going to have to add an additional apparatus. We really don't know the time frame, but what we do know is we've got 20 to 28 months of build time on this piece of equipment. And so a lot can change in that Berry Farms area during that time frame. So we're just trying to be proactive, get it on order, pay for it at today's price, and by the time it comes in, hopefully it'll be where we can staff it with additional personnel.
Or the air compressor. Being honest with you, this is just out of date. It's out of date. It was purchased back in the 1990s. So it's out of date. We need something more modern, more effective and reliable for operations. And we're only asking to replace only one at this point in time. Burn building repairs. We just recently had an inspection on that. It's a 20-year-old building. We did, during this inspection, found some deficiencies that it has. And of course, you know, we utilize this for our personnel to train new firefighters, train on-duty firefighters. So it's just something we need to take care of, some things that we need to take care of, some repairs that need to be done. Overall, if we don't do this, then we only be able to use a portion of the building, and you know, we want to be able to ensure that we can accommodate our personnel. The bailout system, basically NFPA says we have a layout. Every 10 years it has to be, they have to be replaced. So we're in that phase right now, and what we're trying to do is get those up to conversation with our turnout gear. So we're trying to replace as we can now and then put everything on the same rotation together, the bailout kits and also the gear.
And our EMS officer, Sarah Glenn, will walk through a couple of different options on our Life Pack 15s and some upgrades that we may have to do.
So our Life Pack 15 monitors are cardiac monitors for advanced cardiac life support. So we have those on all frontline apparatus. We have the capability for ALS delivery of care on all of those apparatus. We had previously not implemented a replacement schedule for those because, quite honestly, one, they hadn't told us what the end of life date was on those. And then two, typically they come out with new technology before those ever reach an end of life. That's not the case right now. So we have four monitors currently that are reaching an end of life in this coming year. So we will have to replace at least those four. Unfortunately, right now, if you'll notice, you've got two program enhancement requests for the same option. So we've got an option one and an option two. We fall under the direction of Williamson EMS, and they are reevaluating whether they want to stay with the Stryker brand LifePak 15 monitor or if they want to explore the option of switching to the Zoll brand monitors. In order for us to stay compatible with them, if they choose to switch to Zoll, we would need to switch our fleet to Zoll. So I have spoken with them. They will be evaluating that by the summer of 2023. We put this in that if they choose to switch to Zoll, we put it in as a fiscal year 24 impact, but it most likely would be pushed out to fiscal year 25 if that was the case. If that is the case, we would choose not to replace those four LifePak 15s until we're going to replace the entire fleet. But if they choose in the summer of this year to stay with the Striker, the LifePak 15, we would need to replace those four monitors with new LifePak 15s. At this time, the chances are probably pretty slim that they're going to switch to Zoll, but we wanted to put that out there, that it is something that they are going to be evaluating. It is a significant potential impact to us if they do switch to Zoll, not only just these LifePak 15 monitors, but the city as a whole would start switching out AEDs and things like that as well. So it could be a pretty significant financial impact if they do make that switch. That is something they are taking into consideration because that would be a countywide impact. If we stick with the Striker LifePak 15 models, in fiscal year 24, we would be looking to replace four monitors at a cost of $172,600. And then we have a replacement schedule put in place where we replace 1, 3, 3, 1, and 3 over the next 5 or 6 budget years. So,
all right. Thank you, Sarah. Mm-hmm. I'd like to introduce to you Engineer Emily Nelms, who will be discussing our behavioral health and wellness program. I can't say enough about the impact that Emily has made on many lives here in the city and in our department. And I can't say enough good things. Thank you.
In 2022, the fire department launched a behavioral health and wellness program, and we have made great strides in both behavioral health education and support. With regard to education, we conducted over 60 hours of training for the members of the fire department. Specialized additional training was offered to recruits and to officers. The response from our personnel was overwhelmingly positive. Members agree that this program is both necessary and long overdue. 27 fire department personnel expressed interest in helping support program functions moving forward. We've developed 7 committees to assist in areas including peer support, retirement support, family support, budget, policy, information technology, and research. With regard to support, we've provided mental health assistance and resources to over 20 personnel. That's over 10% of the fire department. The assistance received by these individuals fell outside of the current city EAP, as this EAP did not have the skills equipped to address these specific needs. Of the above individuals, one was diagnosed with a cumulative complex post-traumatic stress disorder. This diagnosis and his treatment was life-saving for him. 2 individuals are known to have suffered from suicidal ideation. They were also able to receive the life-saving assistance they needed. We have provided numerous diffusings for crews that responded to potentially traumatic events also. In this short time, our program has already proven to increase quality of life and career for the men and women that work for our department. This budget will help facilitate the continued success of our behavioral health and wellness program.
I can't say enough about how much support that we've received from our city leadership in this area. You know, we've come a long way, but we still have a long way to go. And Emily and her team are working every day to ensure that our personnel get the resources they need to deal with the problems or the issues that they need, that they're experiencing. As we move on to additional requests, Station 3 Architectural Services. This was a conversation that started pre-COVID. Station 3 is our oldest station. We've really outgrown it. And with the construction of New City Hall, we just wanted to start a conversation of maybe moving some of our administrative offices to that station, maybe leveraging some facilities tax and helping in the construction of it, also utilizing some FEMA grant money as a storm shelter. For the bones of it. It would be a blueprint that is similar to Station 7. We would also add an EMS bay on the end of it, so we would have that EMS coverage in that area as well. So we did put that in just to start the conversation and see what options are out there, but it would be a two-story building. We'd move most of our administrative staff to that area, and myself, Chief Baltimore, and Chief King, and Joanne would stay downtown with us along with our admin assistants.
Yes, sir. Right there at the corner of Mallory Station, Seaboard Lane. I'm just going to highlight one of the things over the 3 to 5 year projection. We get a lot of questions about where our next fire station is going. It was Fire Station 9 is going to be annex driven. We're going to be following growth and development, and we'll be continuing watching that. And as concept plans are submitted, we'll be offering a plan of services to service that area. Our 5 to 10 year projection is an increase of personnel, adding additional operational staff, EMS officers, and expanding our special operations unit to include a chief. In conclusion, I couldn't be sitting here today if it wasn't for the support of the men and women that are sitting here and the men and women that are out in the field. Engineer Emily Nelms, EMS Officer Sarah Glenn, Deputy Chief Andy King, Assistant Fire Chief Greg Baltimore, and our Physical Analyst Joanne Finn. They have done a great job in this preparation and ensuring that we've looked at every aspect. One of the things I just, on a personal note, I'd like to say is I appreciate our city leadership and our BOMA for the proactive approach during our most recent compression adjustments. I've received a lot of phone calls, and I know Joanne does too, as well as Chief King, Chief Baltimore, on the appreciation that the men and women of this department have for recognizing it and taking a proactive approach to solve it. Thank you.
Move to the Mallory Station. That's interesting. I like that.
Well, I wish I could tell you it was my idea, but I think it was a Brad Wilson. Yeah. He approached me with that concept pre-COVID. And so we saw an opportunity where we could actually take, we've already got it fit to where we can take Station 7 and put it on that piece of property. Wow. And then go up two stories, create the EMS division and the fire division, and have our administrative division above.
And especially with you still here.
Yes, sir. No, yes, sir. Mr. Tookie won't let us leave.
I'm very attached to my fire leadership.
That was a hard no.
So where there's smoke, you need to be.
Yes, sir.
Any questions of any of the presenters? Butts?
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chair. And of course, we thanked our police department earlier. Naturally, you know, I want to extend the thanks to our fire department. You know, all of our emergency personnel are extremely important to us, and I've always said that prior to serving in this role and when we first moved here. So again, from my family to all of you and all of the rest of this that are here today, you know, thank you. Just in brevity, I wanted to go in because I have toured a couple of the stations, and you had mentioned a couple of things. First is back on slide 29, talking about the shift lieutenants, and
yes,
you mentioned R2 to the rescue 2.
Yes, sir.
If you could give just a little bit more detail on that, why that's needed. And you had said that right now there's not that lieutenant that's on that R2 and we're having to fill in, but it is somewhere else.
So when we initially put this piece of apparatus in service, we staffed it with 3 firefighters.
Okay.
And we've noticed an increase in the call volume. And the specialized technical aspects of that piece of equipment and the duty or the calls that they would go on, we've recognized requires or needs to have a supervisor on there to make those critical decisions. This is not only responds to the public and our visitors, but it also serves as our writ that comes in and gets our personnel if they go down. So it needs a strong leader in that position. We're not going to be asked. We're not asking for new personnel. We're just asking to reassign current personnel to that position to give that apparatus some leadership.
And what do you mean by having a supervisor on that apparatus right now? If there's not a supervisor there, what's that team of 3 supposed to do?
Or they usually rely on the senior firefighter or the battalion chief when he's on scene.
But if they're not on that vehicle, they have to wait for that person to arrive?
They have the latitude to make decisions. Mm-hmm. It's just that with a lieutenant, you get more
advanced.
More training.
Okay.
They've been with the department a little bit longer.
Yes.
Experience.
Okay.
No, go ahead.
Is that
the same? That was that a request last year?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
All right. And that was, I don't see it broken out. I recall it was something like 30. It was a, do you, what is that figure?
52.
It was like 30 to 50 or something like that.
Okay.
So it's an increment. It's an incremental cost to upgrade those positions.
Got it.
Okay. That's right. So we're not adding more personnel. We're just
you're upgrading three firefighter positions to reflect the lieutenant rank.
And I had another question I was trying to capture here in my notes on slide 30. If you would, and this was just like a small flag that kind of popped up in my head. You had mentioned something about parity between our FFFD, our Franklin firefighters, and our Franklin police. And adding the master firefighter pay grade, go into, this is new. This was not there last year, right?
No, sir.
Okay, so what, give a new guy who's here, I'm gonna play the 1 year new guy card. Right. Give us a little bit more on that and why we need that.
Okay, so last year during the pay study, there was a police officer too that was created. And we saw that need that in order to maintain that parity, we could take our people and give them a career path. And if you get that master firefighter, it's not based on seniority. You've got to be able to fill the role of a driver, operator, and an engineer, and an officer. And you have to be here 7 years, and you have to maintain a good evaluation in order to get that position. So there's nothing that's being given there. This kind of, we've got 88 people in one pay grade. So this gives us a little bit of a, or 80, I'm sorry, 84. 84 and one pay grade. So this gives us a little separation. Not everybody in the fire department wants to promote to an engineer or an officer. We have really good firefighters, and the reason our department is the way it is today is because of those firefighters. They're content with being a firefighter. They'll fill in. They have the skills and ability to do those positions above, but they just won't, they don't want to promote up. And but that's not a bad thing. We need them. They do a really good job at what they do. And I, you know, I think when we look at this, we brought it up last year when we noticed this in the pay study, and it was recommended that we bring this back as a PER to get it funded this year. And this initiative, and Joanne can maybe break it down a little bit more, but to take everybody and move it up, it's $259,000 approximately. And I think the market would warrant that.
Okay. I want to clarify a little bit. This was not created through the pay study. It was done ahead of the pay study in response to some dialogue within the police department. And specifically, the issue there was career ladder, kind of like Chief Johnson talked about within the fire department. But it's career ladder, and it's also our ability to retain longtime officers that just want to stay on patrol.
Okay.
So I don't think it's that much different of a logical kind of support for it, but it was done outside of, in advance of the pay study. The pay study just confirmed or identified what the appropriate pay grades were, and we did a number of things there related to it. But I do want to clarify, it did not come out of the pay study. It came out of some other things I identified working with police department, both really frontline folks along with the chief and HR. And so we had implemented that in the budget leading into the pay study. And so the pay study just looked at what we already had on the books. So this is, and Chief's right, when this came up previously, we said, well, this is makes sense to be looked at as a program enhancement.
Okay. And this could also be, as you're, I hear career pathing, career direction as well.
Yes.
You know, from each of
basically, we're using the same roadmap.
And so this might even positively benefit what Alderman Barnhill was referencing on losing those 13 individuals. If we had stronger career pathing, we
yes,
might
most
not
definitely.
Lose. Okay.
The other thing we did last year in conjunction with the pay study was to enhance the payment we do for paramedic stipend, the pay that we provide for paramedics, and then we created the advanced EMT or the AEMT and created a stipend where we didn't have one before. So that was also a recognition of what was going on in the market and our ability to compete and retain people, especially with those specific skills and certifications.
Okay.
I just had one other question, and I appreciate you making reference to Berry Farms, but I always want to make sure that my constituents are well represented as well. But I'm also, I wanted just to get a little bit of understanding, just for public awareness, is we have all of the construction that's currently going on along Carruthers, near Liberty and Carruthers, and in all of those growth areas. And when you referenced another ladder truck, and you've talked about adding another ladder truck, 4, 5, and 8, you know, and that's going to be 30 months out, 30, 36 months out, you know, we're still able to take those ladder trucks because now there are a lot of six-story structures mm-hmm. that are being built. And so there's going to be that demand for that. But before we have that demand, we still have the resources available to meet the public need.
Yes, sir. We have, and it's a tower is what we were requesting in 7. So the tower, we have them strategically placed at 1, 2, and 6.
Excuse me, tower.
And then the tower would, tower 7 would go set to 7. So we would actually just enhance our coverage of the city. Our ladder trucks, yes, they take a 30 to 36 month build, but we have those in service now mm-hmm. that are currently operational and frontline.
Perfect. Thanks.
Any other questions?
I do. Thank you, Chair. 22 unfilled positions. Was that the number?
So right now we have 6 laterals that we've have conditional job offers to.
Oh, good.
And we have 5 in a training academy.
Right.
What Chief Baltimore is referencing, the remaining number of positions that we're not able to fill are people who are on light duty, OJI, we have 1 shift lieutenant that is now at the training center helping with the recruit class mm-hmm. and vacancies.
So I guess the number I'm curious is unfilled positions, not due to, I mean, is there, how many unfilled positions?
Vacancies right now we have 6 and 6. We have conditional job offers out for those.
For those, okay.
Yes, and we hope to have them on board probably in the next week or so, or confirmation that they can come on board.
That helps, because I was sitting here thinking we got 22 unfilled and adding 9.
Right.
And I was like, well, we can't get the 22.
No. We just experienced.
We got to figure something out because we can't, yeah. you know. That's really good. Thank you for that clarification.
Yeah, so what we end up having is when somebody goes on OJI, FMLA,
yeah, yeah.
or it can be long-term.
Sure.
And so.
You got to fill them.
I guess, you know.
We got to have somebody in there.
When somebody calls in sick at the fire department, we have to fill that position. We just can't leave it vacant yeah. that day. So.
Understood. The other thing, I wasn't here for what I assume Michael Walters said, that our budget reflects our values, but I'm sure that was the last meeting because it's can set your clock to that which is a value. But I think Mayor Moore, when behavioral health program, and I've heard this from police as well, and Mayor Moore's initiative with Fine Hope Franklin, and I think probably if you look at the other departments, not just I think certainly the first responders have a complete and different set of behavioral and mental health needs, but I think probably the entire population has more needs than probably pre-pandemic, and I think that's an opportunity, because when I sit in here at the police station yesterday, you know, that's a big part of what's going on, and then I hear what, you know, the fire initiatives, and I think that's an opportunity for us as a city to do something pretty creative, and the needs are probably not the same between departments, but there's probably some overlap, and I think the city could really probably do something pretty neat with behavioral health. I'm sure the mayor's back there already thinking of this.
Well, I think Engineer Nelms can tell you that already she yeah. has had some vision as far as how this might roll into other departments in the Beautiful. City, because there's certainly need, and as many employees we have, there's an opportunity and a need.
Well, just hearing that from police yesterday and hearing this from fire today, maybe it was just you know, making sure we're doing all that and funding whatever we need to do to make sure, you know, our people are taken care of. The other thing, mobile command, that also sounds like an opportunity. I think, like I said, for police, seems like, you know, there's something there for us to do something together, and operationally you all can figure out. I don't know, you know, for large emergencies where you'd want a command center, we have our emergency management center down on Columbia, right?
Right.
And so then you have the day-to-day stuff that kind of seems like vehicularly or equipment need is probably on the low end. And there's this middle range of events where police and fire need some centralization of for their operations. But I don't know that it needs to be separate. Maybe it does. I don't know. I think that maybe further exploring that. And quite frankly, I think this board, if there was a vehicle or something. And then there's the drone situation that sounds like very specific that maybe you don't want to take a big, you know, van out when right. you got to use certain things. So it seems like there may be some unique opportunities to build efficiencies there and give, you know, to meet the needs you're talking about with the technology, but also having everything kind of, not everything in one, maybe it is, I don't know, just an observation. So that would be that comment. And then the master firefighter classification, I think, appreciate City Administrator Stuckey for bringing up that it came before. But I think looking at the police officer 2 and 1 and firefighter class code and in that compression chart, you know, I think y'all showed us compression charts for certain. Mm-hmm. But seeing that in the 88 in the firefighter class code now versus the 2, 1 and 2 police, and just seeing kind of that visually is what I think I've been desiring.
Mm-hmm.
And I think logically, you're right. I mean, I think that there needs to be a career, you know, career track for firefighters as well. And whatever we can do to remain competitive. That's kind of creative stuff that maybe we can do to compete against the people in the surrounding counties, you know, that they don't have and that we might could do. I'm intrigued as Alderman Barnhill is with the Station 3. And I think those are all the comments I have. Thank you.
I'd like to speak real quick to the employee support component and just some other things we've done just in the last couple years. We have this initiative's come through the fire department. I agree it has promise to how it could apply across the organization. And I applaud the leadership of the department and our ability to look at how we look beyond just the basics of the employee, but the whole person and their family. We've enhanced our employee assistance program. We terminated our previous entity and went with a new entity that we think has a deeper bench and more variety of ability to support. But we know especially public safety has some additional and unique needs. And so that's why we're doing what we're doing in the fire department as an initiative there. We did bring on a specific counselor in the police department as a contract that has law enforcement background, decades of law enforcement background to help provide unique support there. So we are looking at it and we'll continue to look at it. And I think as we do these other initiatives, which I love coming from the ground up too, we can learn from that and see how that affects other elements. So we've been working on it for at least a couple years and we'll continue to and try some things and learn from them. And that's I think a great sign that our organization as a whole is thinking that way.
A good opportunity for a public-private partnership too. I'm not just talking, I guess my comments weren't necessarily just about budget-related items either. But public-private partnerships with, you know, the initiative and just getting the resources in front of people and using those, the private partnerships that the mayor's put together. Thank you.
And I will say Engineer Nelms is working closely with our police department, as the mayor said. And so what they've identified as gaps in each of our programs, and, you know, I was encouraged to find out that a lot of the gaps that exist in both of our agencies, the other agency has. So now we can work cohesively together in order to ensure that we're providing the best or giving the most routes to our personnel. So, I mean, that's huge.
Mr. Chair, may I add just a couple of things about the fire department?
Yes.
At this time, I did want to mention also that this is a little bit of a preview for next week, but our facilities team, led by facilities manager Brad Wilson, also supports the fire department and maintaining the facilities in these fire stations. Just a little bit of a preview. When Brad gives his presentation next week, he's going to talk about a couple of roof replacements that he's been, of course, he's maintaining the roofs and the mechanical systems at the fire halls. And so we'll be talking about fire department again next Thursday afternoon in that context of facilities. And so we have a very good working relationship with the fire department and maintaining those facilities. And there are just some things that we have to keep up with. And Brad does a great job. I also mentioned that I'm certainly, Chief Johnson talked about funding the replacement apparatus with tax-exempt bond proceeds. And that's something that we have a very good working relationship with the fire department. And especially as it's so difficult to get these pieces of apparatus and also follow tax-exempt bond rules that the IRS has laid out, that Chief Johnson and his staff works very well with myself and those of us who are trying to follow all those rules and at the same time be as flexible as we possibly can. So we do work very well together to make sure that we can accomplish those even in the most difficult circumstances, on when sometimes we get told that we can't get something for several years, but we have no problems in working together to make that happen.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank
you. Very informative presentation. We appreciate that very much from all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Come back and see us more often.
I'll be here next Thursday. I might need a new roof.
Item 3, government and maintenance. Eric, do you want to lead that off?
I will kick that off. That is the group I work with, including all of you. So we'll start with you. But this is the group that provides really a lot of the centralized management and support for our organization and helps link to your leadership as elected leaders with what our team does as a professional staff. So let's go ahead and get started with that. We'll talk about elected officials, administration. Human resources is in that group, but our HR director, Kevin Townsell, is out of town this afternoon and tomorrow. So he will join us next Thursday with his presentation, but also communications and law in that group. So that's who you'll hear from today. Let's start with elected officials. And you all know that that role that you all have as elected representatives and leaders in the community, and the role you play in approving budgets, adopting ordinances, providing policy direction, and being really a direct connection to the citizens of this community and to the operations, leadership, and policies of our local government. So that's a key function, and you know all the elements in terms of how you're comprised. This org chart really should have all of us pointing directly to the citizens, because the citizens put the alderman and the mayor in place, and ultimately who we're responsive and responsible to. So that is reflected there. And then you see your budget, and it's a really pretty straightforward budget. No significant changes, except fiscal 24 will be an election year for the fall of 23. So we will provide for that. And that's about a $65,000 cost element to support the local election. So that's why you see that operations increase in that line item there. So that's where we continue to work on that, and otherwise it supports your basic operations as we move forward. All right, in administration, this is the role I serve as your city administrator. Angie Johnson heads up our city recorder team and that administrative element, as well as the office and support staff within our administration team. And as I said before, we are the folks you appoint to provide that central leadership of the administrative elements, the day-to-day operations, the recommendations to you of budgets and policy direction, and charting that strategic direction of the city at your guidance, but with professional insight and help along the way, both in what we provide, but also facilitating that coming from all the folks you're hearing from at the departmental level and that departmental leadership. Here's our org chart. You see some of the folks that report to the city administrator and that you're hearing from today. and along with three assistant city administrators, and as we identified, police and fire as well. So that's our org chart, not significantly changed at all from what you've got in place today. And then you see our numbers, which again are largely flat or consistent with where we are right now. Some adjustments in those assumptions that Michael talked through in terms of especially the benefits component. And so it's really a pretty much a status quo budget of what we have. Although, Mike, you might want to remind them about what those negative numbers mean.
So this is the first budget of the year that I get to explain an accounting tool, which is somewhat dangerous because I'm trained, like Eric, as a city administrator, not an accountant. But we use a tool called indirect cost accounting, or what we label an interfund transfer. There are 10 departments that get this, and what that is it is a transfer of up to 20%, actually more in revenue management's budget. We'll talk through that next week. But otherwise, it's 9 departments where 20% of their overall expenses are charged off to your 3 business type activity funds: water management, sanitation, and stormwater. And there's a variety of ways and a variety of complexities that we could use. We choose to keep it relatively simple. One way of looking at it is like this. We have roughly 770 employees in this organization. There's roughly 160 to 170 that are accounted for in those 3 departments. That's about 20%. So it's rather reasonable that 20% of, for example, the human resources department time would be spent working on the functions of those departments. So administration certainly is one of those departments. Finance is one of them. Purchasing is one of them. So you'll see negative numbers in other departments, or you'll see that offset, and that is what that is. Final note, we do look at this annually. We'll be looking at it again this year to see if it's responsible. Again, the only time you get in trouble, if you will, is if you try to charge too much off to these ratepayer-based funds. So we try to be fair and balanced regarding, you know, reasonability levels, and then balance it between taxpayer-supporting operations and the ratepayers. Eric.
So one of the other things that's on that slide, and I want to... Your city recorder team is behind me. So Angie Johnson has stepped in the role as city recorder and been with us for like 3 years now, three and a half, and played a central role in our transition to Civic Clerk and some of the other technology enhancements we've done the last couple years. And she stepped into that role. Casey Anderson is our new deputy city recorder, recently promoted, and has also just been named our employee of the quarter. So we're just referring to her as employee of the quarter, Casey Anderson, yes. And then our newest addition, Sarah Schilling, is our assistant deputy recorder, city recorder. So one of the things they're looking at is the update of our public records or public retention, records retention policies. Those have been in place in elements for a long time. There are regular tweaks to it, but we're taking a little more of a comprehensive review. We're also continuing to look at how we respond to records requests and do that efficiently, both in terms of what we monitor, how we manage it from the central function, but also how it works in the individual departments. So that's some of the focus of that element, and I'm very grateful for the work and leadership of this group and helping support what you do, what I do, what the whole organization does. So I just want to recognize them that they're here, but we're not specially bringing them in because they're always here. So we appreciate that. All right, and we do have one program enhancement, and we're calling it a customer service liaison position. What it essentially is a position dedicated to the area right outside this door where people come in. They may ask questions, get directed, and it's a role we tried to share with some of the function of the recorder function, and it's just a difficult blending because the time and attention that some of those efforts, like doing minutes for one of your meetings, takes while being regularly interrupted by a phone call or somebody coming in just wasn't conducive. So we're looking at a dedicated position out there to sort of welcome the public, help guide them, get them where they need to go in person, but also you know, when people call in or need help or assistance. So it's just a dedicated service, kind of ambassador type of position that would sit right outside these doors and welcome the public. Angie, did I do okay? Anything?
You did an excellent job.
Okay. All right. So that's the one enhancement that is being requested through the administration department.
Is the 41 or the 48, is that salary and benefits?
Yes.
That is. Yeah.
With the role, maybe we should just keep going. There's now time.
That's fine. If you want to ask.
So would it be supporting the city recorder's office additionally, or is it really because because we had talked?
Yeah.
I don't want to go down this rabbit hole right now, but here we go. Because I do think that from our standpoint as aldermen too, kind of a centralized customer service, a lot directing, because we're directing a lot of our citizen requests to you.
Right, right.
I can imagine, and or, you know, department heads, and not to mention those of us that go rogue and go to an employee. You know, I think that having that kind of, when I say go rogue public, I mean that we go to an employee directly in the city, and it has to drain time from everyone's schedule. So it may not be this position, but having a centralized support for that maybe makes that customer service experience for citizens contacting us on certain things.
This role is a little more direct interaction with the public and support there. There may be some things we assign. We're actually working on some ways to centralize the management of kind of service requests, information requests that come in through you all, and how those get managed in ways you can access and get a status report anytime related to those. And so that's still working. This team will help that happen. That position may help support it, but it needs to be really largely available to respond to the public. And so the additional responsibilities would need to be compatible with that.
Yeah, may I add what the goal is? Right now, the help that is given to the public, phone, in person and such, is spread out through several of our staff members. So by putting it and letting just one person really focus on giving their time and attention to that, it's going to then hopefully allow our other staff more time to do exactly those things. So that kind of thing is definitely needed. It probably wouldn't be assigned to that person, but we will then have more capacity to take that on in a different, more appropriate position.
Well, I'm not sure what always, I knew what some of us said. But I don't see that being the person that you would call to get a pothole filled.
If they get that call, they would be trained to say, how do we put in a service request and that sort of thing.
Maybe we'll go to direct that call to that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But, I see that being someone coming off the street that's a tourist that they're looking for whatever the map shows that the next feature and attraction is for the city of Franklin. Mm-hmm. Where do you go see that and get that done then? But because it used to be
we've had that,
but it was never
we've had that from time to time, and it's always been sort of shared, and we're just looking at how we might dedicate somebody that said there's always that presence every day and consistently helping give people that direction and that welcome to City Hall.
This could be the reincarnation of Marshall Liggett. See, I'm talking before you, because that was Marshall after he left the city administrator's job.
Changed a little bit. And then just to summarize, you know, our team strives to support your leadership in the community, connect it to the leadership that comes from our professional staff, and put us in a place where we're meeting the needs of the community, but also charting the right course for the future. Every team member focuses on the five qualities that we talk about in terms of excellence, innovation, teamwork, acting with integrity, and being action-oriented. And we strive to support that in everything we do. So thank you for giving us this time, and glad to answer any other questions you might have.
Any additional questions?
All right, let's bring our communication team up to talk about what they what they're asking for and what they do.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Melissa Ryerson, and this is Monique McCullough, and we're representing our communications team today. Thank you for having us. And the communications division was founded 15 years ago when I came to the city, so I've been here 15 years, and Monique's been here close to 23 years. So we've been here a little while, and we focus on internal and external communications and participation, citizen participation, trying to get the public involved in what we're doing. And we also handle the city's public access channel, Franklin TV, and all social media and our website. And you can see our organization chart there. And we have a great team. I'm so fortunate to work with these folks. They're very talented, all of them. We have Stephen Price, our social and digital media producer, Monique McCullough, Robert Mott, who is taping this right now as we're watching. And then we have our part-timer, Joey Echeverria, and he is our part-time production assistant at this moment. So I was going to share with you a few stats and a funny picture because we like to have fun. Our social media stats for 2022, increasing Franklin's overall information wellness and quality of life like a smoothie, delicious, healthy, and sweet. That's what we try to do with our social media. So if you look at our overall social stats for all of our channels, and this is not including the Franklin PD Twitter and the Franklin Fire Twitter and Talk Twitter, but this is just our main channels, Facebook, Instagram. We were on TikTok for a little bit, YouTube. So overall, 13.8 million impressions, 150.6 thousand followers, and 3.5 million video views, which is pretty good for a little town of just over 80,000 people.
And that's just 2022.
Yeah. That was just last year. So that was good. And last year we had fun and we kind of changed up our social media approach. We looked back at our stats and what was the most looked at posts and things like that. And we decided to kind of take a more fun approach. We're already fun, but we tried to be more fun. And we were doing more Reels styles and TikTok styles, shooting vertically instead of horizontally. On Facebook, we were finding that our photographs were getting more engagement than videos, which back when we started, it was Facebook was all video and Instagram was the pretty pictures. Well, now it's Instagram's the videos and Facebook is the pictures. And I think our change up in approach paid off. In Facebook, we improved compared to the previous year. Our reach improved 174.9% and our reach in Instagram 494.4%. So that's pretty amazing. Mm-hmm. And then just visits to our profiles, when they actually go to our Instagram page or our Facebook page, that increased on Facebook 106.5% and on Instagram 82.2%. And then you can see our new followers increased 3,423 on Facebook and Instagram 4,783. And you can see some of the pictures of some of the videos that we did and kind of the branding with the different words, and I think that got a lot of people's attention. As you look here, you can see all the numbers for Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Facebook continues to be get our highest impressions, 7.6 million, 4.1 million for Instagram, and 3.4 million impressions for Twitter. Our video views are pretty good on Facebook, but like I said, we kind of slowed that down, so it's 351. And if you look at our Reels, 160 Reels we produced and 2.1 million Reels plays, and then 1.2 million video views, and I think that's all videos. We produced 351 videos for Facebook, so that's a lot of output that we're doing, you know, on all of our channels. And if you look at it, some things we just put on Instagram, some things on Facebook, sometimes we put everything on every channel. And then Twitter, we had 170.5 thousand profile visits and 485 tweets. We don't get as much engagement with Twitter, but people are seeing the information we put there. You can see our top posts. This was when Michael Walters Young, this was a kind of a shout out. It was pretty cool on Twitter when he did his Mad Money thing for the State of the City. And he was just like Mad Money. Well, they noticed us. They gave us a shout out on the Mad Money Twitter, which was pretty cool. We were trying to get Ted Lasso to do it, but we didn't get that. But maybe next time. And then Ryan Schumann, Officer Ryan Schumann, is doing a great job with his videos, getting millions of views and going viral. And he's getting recognized almost everywhere he goes now, so he's pretty popular. And then the things that we do with our employees, people seem to like it. And this was a fun thing that we did. It was an homage to the movie. What was that movie? Where? Love Actually. Yes, Love Actually. And so our employees were doing their Love Actually signs. And I think people like that. It was kind of trending at the moment. We try to keep up with the trends of what the kids are doing. So I can't categorize myself as a kid. So. But I do have them, and they give me feedback all the time. So our website is doing great. You can see our top three visited pages. We had over 1 million page views. Of course, people like to go there to pay their bill. Annual events and festivals, they like to know what's going on in Franklin. And our Franklin Police Department is popular on our website as well. You can look at our YouTube, 2 million impressions, 154,000 video views, and 257 video posts. But that number seems a little low because it probably didn't include our meetings and things like that that we've posted. And we are also on Nextdoor, which I didn't put that on here. This is Nextdoor right here at the bottom. And we have 35,749 members. We don't post on there as much. I think we could probably up that, but we kind of just put the really important posts on Nextdoor. And then we're still getting pretty high impressions just with 12 posts there. So we don't have a big change to our base budget. Just a basic healthcare premium forecasts. And then the annual tree lighting is going up a little bit, just the production costs. We're not doing a lot more. We're just the cost of having the stage and the outside people come in and put up the lights and all that stuff has gone up at almost, how much did it go up about?
$10,000,
yeah. But we do get sponsors that help us pay for that. So they cover most of the costs for that. So we did ask for a little bit more because things are going up, and we'll ask more from our sponsors as well. The only thing that were the program enhancement that we're doing, last year we asked for our part-timer to go full-time because we are producing so many videos, and it's good to have that redundancy. If something happens to Robert, we have someone else who can be there that knows how to run the equipment, set it up, and do the videos of your meetings and the things that are most important in transparency for our community. And then we did ask for a part-time position to help in our special events public outreach area. And so this year, we didn't get those things last year. So this year I decided to get creative with the dollars and try to combine those two positions. And so we would bring that production person full time, but they would work half of the time with production and then half of the time with Monique. So they would report to Robert and Monique. And since Monique is close to her 25 years, she could retire in 2 years, which she hasn't said that she's going to do. But we really need to get someone in and start training on the special events, the public expression events, the film permits. I mean, we're really busy with those, and she's working a lot of nights and weekends on those events. And it would be really good to have someone to come in and learn that process and help us with that. So, and Joey has expressed interest in doing that. And he has a little bit of a background with his family and working special events. And so that would be our only request this year. And then in summary, I just put a few of our accomplishments from 2022 and 2023. We did implement Site Improve in our site. It's a monitoring site for our web, a monitoring software for our website that monitors our site to make sure that we are ADA compliant, so all can see and view our site. And we have liaisons in each department that kind of work with that software. And so that's been good for our website. We updated our approach to social media. We had our first Citizens Government Academy since the pandemic, and we got a lot of good feedback on that. People were really excited to be there and amazed that it was something that we offered for free. and they learned a lot. And then we've gone viral with many of our videos that we've changed, and especially with Police Officer Ryan Schumann. And then we partnered with lots of community organizations for video projects. And then 33 special events, 6 public expression events, and 21 film permits issued. And then on the horizon, we have a lot of parks projects that are going to come to fruition. We're working with Planning Department and Vision Franklin process, assisting the Water Management Department. Just doing a lot of things. Hope to get new banners on Main Street. We're going to go to a crisis communications conference in Chicago, and Social Media Marketing World. Steven's going to go to that and find out the latest in social media. So cool. Thank you so much for your support. We appreciate it, and thank you for doing the silly things that we sometimes ask you to do. But I think everybody loves it, so the public does. Anyway.
I just wanted to say, because I missed the last Board of Mayor and Alderman meeting, I have been on and watched it, you know.
Good.
Any other questions? Unless, Monique, thank you very much.
Thank you both. Thank you.
25 years goes back a long time.
Let's bring on the whole law department. You got the whole crew here. We have some chairs over here.
Yep. So we moved them back.
This is the law department. They keep us out of trouble, right?
we certainly do our best.
There they are.
They try to, yeah. But
all right.
Yeah, we got chairs for everybody. Michael, you need one more?
One more.
So I thought it was important to bring the whole team up for a couple reasons. One, we have a lot of new faces that maybe you guys haven't been introduced to yet. But also, we are your council, and I want you to be able to, you know, feel comfortable coming to see us and knowing who to talk to and what we do. So I'm obviously Shauna, I'm your city attorney. And then I guess I'll just let you guys introduce yourselves. That might be a good way to do it.
I'm Bill Squires. I'm the assistant city attorney. You all have met me. Hello, everyone. Hi, I'm
Blake. You have to turn on your mic. Sorry, that's rule number one.
I'm Blake Harper. I'm the new staff attorney. This is week 3 for me.
Yeah. I'm Tabitha Langley. I'm one of the paralegals, and I've been here about 3.5 years.
I'm Lisa Mooring. I'm a new paralegal, and I started in October.
And I'm Amy Sue Banker, and I'm the legal assistant.
So this is our team. We're just going to talk a little bit. I have probably the shortest budget and maybe the shortest presentation, so you guys can get out of here. So the purpose of the law department is set forth in the municipal code. I'm not going to read it. It's in there for you. But it does say that there are certain things that we have to do. For example, reading contracts, approving them, the resolutions, the ordinances. We give counsel to the board, mayor, alderman. We attend the meetings. We also give counsel to our elected and appointed officials as may be required. And then we litigate on behalf of the city, either defense or prosecution, however that might work out. So you can tell that we had a lot of resolutions and ordinances that we looked at and drafted, as well as contracts. You know, 371 is a pretty high number, but we do a lot of work. All of our departments are very busy, but most of what we do requires a contract of some sort. We had 98 litigation cases opened and 95 closed, and most of those are city court cases. We have a lot of contested city court cases. So that takes Bill and Tabitha's time at least once a month. And we, in those situations, we play the video and present in front of the judge, like kind of like you would in an actual court setting. We had a 405 task, but when you think about a task, that's a matter. It doesn't tell you how many times we touch the thing. So, a task might stay open for a year, and we may work on it for months and months and months, similar to like the public gathering and expression event, for one example. But also, I just wanted to share a couple of other accomplishments. As you know, we provided training to the appointed and elected officials this year. It was almost close to a full day of training. We did settle our class action lawsuit this year, and that was good. That case had been going on for 12 years, I think. We did require some new software for the law department, and we've been implementing that. Amy Sue has been heading that up, and she pretty much created the whole database and then trained us and then also our departments on how to use it. So that's been really, really helpful. Our numbers are going to be a little different next year because we'll be able to report in different ways, and we're really, really excited about that. I think that's all for the accomplishments. Here's our org chart. Again, here's our faces. We aren't the communications, so we couldn't make the really fancy org chart. But I talked to Chris, and we're going to figure out a way to make that happen next year.
They'll have pictures next year.
That was pretty fantastic. That's our staff. This is our base budget. No additional requests for personnel. There is some decreases because of benefit elections. And then some of our capital has – there's some capital line items that have – or operation line items that have increased because everything's more expensive. It's more expensive to travel. It's more expensive to go to conferences. Everybody's raising their rates, and every one of us need to get our continuing education. And that's just kind of the way it is and where we are right now. We have no program enhancements. I do want to remind you, though, that we do carry in a line item all of the legal services for the city. So if we need someone outside to come help us, that's all within our department, regardless of where it comes from. And we also carry the lobbyist services in our department. And we appreciate your time. I don't know if Eric wanted to add anything.
Any questions? Job, and you got to see a whole department.
Yeah. This is the whole department.
Police and fire did not bring their entire department.
Well, a lot of them.
Not
the whole.
172.
Yeah.
Yep, this is us. Any questions?
Thank you. We appreciate
thank
that.
You. You're welcome.
Thank you. It's good to have all of you here. We love to see that.
So I believe that concludes our departmental reviews for today. We'll be back in a week to talk through the finance and administration group, Christine's group. So I think we're moving on to monthly reports, if you'd like to, Mr. Chair.
All right. Margaret, you're up.
I will be the shortest of today.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hey, and maybe I can get you out of here by 5 o'clock. All right. You can ask Mike. He's sitting right back there. three highlights. Sales tax continues to be strong. On average, we're 4.8% higher than last year. Hotel motel tax, on average, we're 16.8% higher than last year. And the conference center has had profits for 5 of the 6 months. Any questions?
Good highlights.
We yield to Alderman Baggett.
No, I'm good.
Just trying to keep us on our game.
All right, I got 45 seconds.
I got 2 minutes, according to my watch.
All right.
You're up.
Oh, I don't have a question.
You said you had 45 seconds. And any questions of Margaret? You know, I miss seeing Mike up here at this chair also. You know,
he's got a pretty big smile on his
face.
He's here
today.
He's okay.
He's happy.
Mike isn't far away. He's always thinking about it.
He's always here.
Any questions of Mike? See if we can put him on the spot. All right. If none, any other thing to come before the committee?
Just the reminder that we're going to meet in a week. So we're into our unique budget schedule where we're doing 2 in a month. And in fact, in March, we're going to do 3 in that month because we're bumping the early April meeting into that very last part of March. So we'll be here next Thursday at 3 o'clock to continue the departmental reviews. And thank you for your time and attention.
Sounds good to me. And I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Proper motion to a second.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.